Howdy, y'all, and welcome back to our course, Databases Demystified, sponsored by Fivetran. I'm your host, Michael Kaminsky. Today, we're going to be talking about a really important concept in databases that you might have heard of before, indexes. Indexes are used to make queries go faster, and they can be found in lots of different contexts in databases. Of course, like everything else that we've learned so far in this course, there are trade-offs when using indexes, so it's important to understand how they work. So here's the summary. Indexes make queries go faster, so we can use them to speed up our applications or to improve query times for analytics. However, indexes take up extra space in the database, and they can make some of our operations slower. Before we start talking about indexes in the context of databases, I want to review how we use indexes in the physical world, how you might have used indexes before in your own life. It turns out that database indexes work very similarly to these real-life indexes. So, once we have a good intuition for how to use a real-life index, it'll be easy to understand how database indexes work. One good example is a card catalog. These don't really exist in physical format anymore, but when I was growing up, we used to have card catalogs to look up which books in the library might contain a certain topic. My mother still uses one of these boxes for her recipes, so that she can quickly find a recipe for a certain cookie or a certain type of bread or a certain shrimp dish. The other really common place to encounter an index is in the back of a book, generally a nonfiction book or a textbook. So if you have a textbook that's long and covers lots of different topics, you might have an index in the back that can point you toward a certain topic that you're interested in, or that you might want to find again. So now, let's talk through the steps that we would follow when we use a book index. We're going to cover the steps that you take to use an index in a weird amount of detail, because I want to show you how some things that you do naturally and easily are referred to as algorithms when a computer does them. It turns out that when you use an index, you're going to use an algorithm called binary search that is very important in computing, and that's what makes indexes so powerful. So let's get started. Let's imagine that we have a dense textbook with 1,000 pages. We want to find a certain topic that we know is in the textbook, but we don't want to have to flip through every page to see if the topic is there. In the worst case scenario, we'd have to read every page in the whole textbook just to find what we're looking for. However, if the textbook has an index, we can use the index to find the topic that we're looking for and then jump quickly to the correct page in the book. This will be many times faster than trying to read every page. The most important thing to notice about the index that we're going to use is that it's organized by topic and that these topics are sorted alphabetically. The fact that the index is ordered via known system, in our case, alphabetical, that allows us to use binary search to find the topic that we're looking for. So, even if you aren't familiar with the term binary search, you've definitely done it many, many times in your life. Binary search is the process of flipping back and forth between entries to zero in on the thing that we're looking for. You might start too low, then flip a bit too high, then flip a bit lower, then a bit higher, all until you land on the page that you're looking for. You can imagine doing that in a phone book. So we're going to take this process step by step. Let's imagine that we're looking for the topic frogs in our index. If we start out on the index and flip to a random page, maybe we see the entry for trees. We know that F for frogs comes before T for trees, so we know that the entry for frogs must be earlier in the index. So we flip to an earlier page, and we see the entry for dogs. We know that F comes after D, so we know that frogs must be on a later page, but still before the page where we found trees. So we flip to a later page. Now we see lava. We're getting closer, but we're not there yet. We know that we need to go back, but not as far back as we found dogs. We repeat this process until we zero in on the entry for frogs, and then we look up the correct page in the textbook to find out all about our favorite amphibians. This zeroing in process is what's known as binary search, and it works because we all know the alphabet, and so we can use binary search to find the topic that we're interested in. If you were given a textbook in Russian that used the Cyrillic alphabet, you wouldn't be able to use this algorithm because you wouldn't know the sorting system, unless, of course, you know the Cyrillic alphabet or you speak Russian. Before we move on, we should talk about the cost of having an index for a textbook. There are two big ones. One, the index takes up space. That's a lot of extra pages that you have to print and carry around with you. Additionally, the index makes the book more expensive because you have to pay someone to actually create the index accurately. This takes a lot of time and effort, especially if you want to do it well. So, now let's talk about database indexes. Fortunately, databases use indexes very similarly to how we use indexes in books, so we can use a lot of the same intuition to understand how these work. So let's imagine that we have a users table with millions of users in it. We've got an ID column that is incremented as users are created in our application, and the rows are sorted by this column so that the users created earliest at the top and the users that are created most recently are at the bottom. We also have a first name and a last name column, which are obviously not sorted in any meaningful way since users are added to this table when they sign up for our application. If we want to look up a row from this table where we're filtering by last name, for example, if we want to find the row for myself, Michael Kaminsky, this is going to be very slow for the database. Since the data aren't ordered by last name, the database is going to have to start at the first row, check if last name equals Kaminsky, then move to the second row, check if last name equals Kaminsky, then move to the third row, and repeat that for every single row in the table. This is a problem for us because if we are going to do this sort of filtering or querying very frequently, then our database is going to be very slow. So what we want to do is create an index on the last name column that will allow us to find rows by last name much faster. So let's look at what an index on last name would look like for that table. What we're doing here is just creating another table that's going to be sorted so that we can look up the location of the row in the original table by last name. Because this new lookup table is sorted, we can take advantage of binary search to make the lookup process much faster. So now that we have an index, when we filter on last name, the database knows that it can use the index that is sorted to be able to identify the Kaminsky row much faster. We do this by using binary search, the same way that we looked for the topic frogs at the beginning of this lesson. So if we start at row 3 and we see Melchor, we know that it has to be before that. So maybe we bounce up to the first row and we see Cairo, but we know it's after that. So then we're able to zero right in on the Kaminsky row. So now we can look up where the rest of the information is on the original table so that we can get access to the rest of the information from our query, the first name, the ID, etc. So you might think what a lot of people think when they first realize how powerful these indexes are. Why don't we put indexes on everything? Then all of our queries will be really fast, right? Of course, the answer is, and you'll be familiar with this if you've watched the other lessons in this series, that there are trade-offs. Database indexes, just like our book indexes, have costs. There are two costs associated with database indexes. First, just like with our book indexes, additional database indexes take up extra space in the database. So for every index that we're adding, we're taking up additional hard drive space in the database because we're creating additional tables. Depending on the type of the database that you're using and the size of the data that you're working with, this can end up being a real problem. Second, and even more importantly, additional indexes can slow down your database when it's doing different types of operations. For every index that we add to a table, it means that updating data or adding additional data is going to be slower because the database has to not only update the original table with all of the data in it, but also all of the indexes as well. So the more indexes that we have, the slower updates and writes are, but the faster your reads are going to be. So that's a really important trade-off. If we want to keep our indexes up to date and we put lots of indexes on a table that's being updated frequently, we could end up slowing our application down meaningfully. An important thing to know is that there are lots of different types of indexes, and these indexes can be specialized for different types of data. All of these indexes generally work the same way, but they might be slightly more efficient for certain types of columns or for columns that have more or less unique values, for example. Unless you're really fine-tuning a database, it's not critically important to know in detail what all of these differences are. Different databases will have different special documentation on how to use the different indexes. If you're at the point where you really need to get into the weeds with these different definitions, you can go look up that specialty documentation for the database that you're working with. So that's all that we have for today. Just to summarize, indexes are a very important and very powerful tool for increasing the efficiency of certain queries in a database. But they slow down database writes and updates in order to update the index. And they take up additional space in your database. That's it. Thanks for tuning in. Hopefully you learned something today. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel. It really helps us out a lot. We've got lots more great lessons coming up, so stay safe and we'll see you in the next one.